Hello, friends, and welcome to the 26th episode of a mostly new Marvel Snap podcast, Snap Judgments. As always, I'm Roy Rogers, and I'm joined by my friend and yours, Aaron Glazer. How are you doing on this wonderful, wonderful May evening?
I'm great. I'm really excited. Happy to be here. Happy to be back doing this.
As am I, after my computer like died in the middle of our last recording of this. It was all kinds of fun times. But we are not today joined by our usual co-host, Chris Lavin. Glazer, who are we joined by this week?
So longtime listeners know that I really love giving a voice to smaller creators and trying to help get them like promoted and so people will know their name. So I'm hoping that you guys will all look, you're all here for him. It's Cambest.
No, I really appreciate you guys letting me use your platform. It's very, very helpful for me in terms of growth. No, I mean, honest to God, thank you for having me. I'm not used to doing this sort of stuff, right? Like people asking me to do podcasts is not normal for me. And as someone who ran an unrelated, probably 5-listener NBA podcast for like 3 years of my life, I get it. So there you go. There's your exclusive. There's your Cam Best scoop. I don't think anyone knew that about me. So there you go. I did previously run a podcast that discussed sports. Well, I don't know if I ran it. It was me and another guy. He did most of the actual stuff. This pattern holds true.
So in my life. You like the NBA and wrestling? I'm really just like all about this now.
Yeah, I mean, I'm. There's not much of a difference not between anymore. The two now, is there? A lot of great storylines in the NBA that have nothing to do with basketball. Yeah,
I'm so
if you I feel like the crossover of the NBA and wrestling is like Patrick Beverly.
I mean, probably it's the '90s like, Knicks for sure. Oakley, Mason.
I don't know. I feel like there's like a degree of showmanship that like they were all about it. The '90s Knicks are like they believed it. Or like you look at like the Bad Boys Pistons, it's like back when people believed wrestling was real. But now the modern day wrestler is Patrick Beverly.
I could see that. It's the Knicks were like the it's still real to me guy. I got it.
Yeah.
We lost, right, Roy.
So you did not lose me. I'm quite
capable. No, I got it. I know this is what you all came here to hear is me talk about things like this. That's exactly the reason that I'm on this podcast.
Well, yes. We are in my favorite time of the year when it comes to basketball, which is the 76ers have been eliminated, so I don't have to care about basketball for like 4 months. So,
God, wait, are you a Sixers fan or a Sixers
fan? I'm a Sixers fan. I'm a Philly sports fan. So,
my condolences.
I chose this life. I mean, literally actually I just feel like chose you gotta this life. So,
yeah, no, it's like, I mean, I don't know, like you talk about a team with Joel Embiid and Doc Not Rivers anymore. And James Harden on it, and like you expect anything other than a second round exit in the most annoying possible way.
Yeah, I literally threw my phone across the room.
Just the most annoying possible thing. I cannot imagine. Like, this is probably like what? The last 5 years, there have been like 3 all time awful Sixers playoff runs.
I mean, that's just every Doc Rivers coach team, though. Like, every Doc, doesn't matter where he is.
Yes, but like, be fair to Doc, he had some help here.
He did. Like,
he had some generational chokers in their own right.
He did.
Okay. So, speaking of generational choking, I've never won a match in a Marvel Snap tournament.
Is that actually true? Is that actually true?
I've entered 1 Marvel Snap tournament. So, technically, that is true, as far as I'm aware.
I guess you did get swiftly eliminated from that tournament that, like, Kibler and Hooglin did a really deep run.
Yeah. No, I'm washed. I'm the James Harden of Marvel Snap. I will never make it past the second round.
That's a really good line. I like that. Maybe we'll
big numbers, big counting stats. No conversion.
So I hate shorts, but we're definitely making that a short.
All right. Always glad to help. Before we get deep into this, all right, Cam. If there is for some reason someone listening to this, and the thing, of course, about the internet is you never know that there is probably someone listening to this who has not heard of you. Where could they find you on social media, and where can they find you streaming most days?
twitch.tv/kmbestms, twitter.com/kmbestms, and YouTube, kmbest in a snap. I do want to like get this out front, though. I apologize for the use of the word best. I feel like people think I have that in there because I think I'm the best player. That's not why it's there. It was because my previous name was a pun on Kanye West, and then he got really racist, and now it is no longer a pun on Kanye West because I did not want to be associated with that. So I feel like people should know that about me. Anti-racism. Definitely not like, oh, I'm the best Marvel Snap, because I get like 5 sarcastic comments every so often. Like, oh yeah, you're the best, right? It's like, no, man, it's a name. I'm sorry. I'm stuck with it.
I think I actually started following you when you switched names. I think you handled it with a lot of grace and aplomb. And the name does roll off really well. So as far as like pivots go, I think it's like
that's actually why there's a second syllable.
Oh, that makes sense.
Like, it doesn't mean anything. I just wanted a second syllable. Like, there's no, the K and the M mean there, it doesn't stand for anything. I thought there should be a second syllable. Because if you like K best, I sound like a 90s rapper. And not like a good 90s rapper, like one of the ones that was on like a Mary J. Blige song and then you never heard of them
actually
again. Like, I'm
sorry, you sound like a Batman villain with K-Best. Like, I'm just sorry. That's really what you sound like. Yeah. To me. Like, I'm just going to be honest.
Whatever it is, it's not flattering.
All right. We don't have the entire episode, our usual very rambling episodes with Cam here, Mr. Best. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to just say real quick where you can find us on Twitter, which is @SnapJudgeCast. And of course, most importantly to Aaron, our YouTube, which is @SnapJudgmentsPod. So Glazer, real quick, tell our loyal listeners what they could expect if they go to the YouTube channel right now.
So, all right, I'm going to give my actual like Cam Best spiel. I have a Cam Best spiel that I do at the beginning of videos, and I'm just going to do it with you here. So,
what
ready?
What does that even
so
mean?
When you follow a small creator, when Cam Best posts a video, and you go on ladder, everyone is playing that deck. Everyone on earth plays the Cam Best deck. If I post a deck, you get to be slightly ahead of the curve. You get like, if I can find it fast enough, you get to play it before other people do, and it gives you the chance to hit infinite. So I've been looking for those decks, and like, look, I'm not finding the smallest decks in the world. I pushed the WWO deck about 30 seconds before it hit everything. But the goal is to find the decks that you can get to infinite with, especially at the end of the season, as you're trying to get your last grind in, hopefully staying slightly ahead of the larger creators.
So I will say, I that is a thing that happens. When I was in the process of making the Iron Patriot list, like literally 5 games into it, before I'd posted a tweet or a video, the 5th game I played was a mirror against someone in my chat. So that does happen.
Inevitable. It's the burden of destiny.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I think that is a really good transition to what our main topic today is going to be, which is sort of, I mean, look, we have Cam Best. It's in the name, right? We're going to be talking about the sort of how to get to the top level of Marvel Snap. And I think before we can really talk about that, we need to sort of talk about like identifying what the top level means sort of to you and how you play. So we'll start with you, Cam. So like, how do you choose a good deck or a good set of decks to play with? Does it have to meet a certain standard? And what are sort of the most important factors that for you go into that decision?
Kind of an open-ended question. Okay, so generally speaking, what you do is you assess the metagame to the best of your abilities, and that's a pretty nebulous thing. So one really easy way to do that is to just like go on Untapped and sort by win rate, because cube rate is fake. So you go on Untapped and sort by win rate, and you're like, okay, these are the things you see that like have 200 games on the decks or whatever, right? Like, but that doesn't really tell you the whole story. You have to like kind of absorb a little bit more than that. On a more fundamental level, you have to just be like, okay, if I see deck X, what is my plan? If I see deck Y, what is my plan? And then when you play deck X and deck Y, you're like, all right, what do I lose to? And then when you try to like make something to fit into that, it's like you're machining a puzzle piece and you are trying to create that based on the parameters that are defined to you by the metagame, except you can't actually see what shape the puzzle piece has to be. You just kind of guess what shape the puzzle piece has to be, and then you mess up and fail, and like one out of every 10 decks actually is good. It's pretty much like that. You just take a million shots, and then sometimes something that sounds really good in your head does not end up being really good in practice, and you just have to live with it and move on and be like, well, I guess I whiffed on that one. And if you can figure out why you whiffed, then that's good. But most of the time you can't, because there's so many variables in any game like this that you just have to keep firing bullets.
Quick follow-up, because I want to throw to Glazer and hear his opinion about this. But Cam, when you said that sort of cube rate is fake, what did you mean by that? Because
it is fake.
How is it fake? Because it's a very popular metric, right? Like, you watch a lot of videos, and we've talked about it on our own show. So I want to sort of hear sort of your perspective as someone who makes, I think, a very excellent tier list every time and has a good sense of the data.
Decks don't have inherent cube rate. Cube rate is dependent on your opponent not knowing what's going on. So if you are doing something that can catch your opponent by surprise, or if you're just a good player, like, decks, I think, can have inherent cube rate to, you know, some degree, right? When you look at, like, okay, Sarah Control. I get why a deck like that would have a higher cube rate than a deck that telegraphs all of its power plays. I get that. There's a lot of ambiguity in your turn six, right? That makes a ton of sense. I get why Sarah Control would have a higher cube rate than Galactus, right? Kind of one is a known quantity. Even though Sarah's kind of a known quantity, there's still a lot of question marks around with Sarah. I get it, right? But mostly, that's because there's so much ambiguity in terms of what you're running in your Sarah deck and what they have to play around. Like, that is kind of the thing. Like, if you're playing Sarah without Enchantress, well, they still kind of have to be afraid of the Enchantress because they don't know that you're playing Sarah without Enchantress, right? Like, that's... cube rate comes from uncertainty. And if you are able to generate that uncertainty, I think, generally speaking, it also comes from being able to snap well. So I will always take a deck with a higher win rate and trust in my snapping than a deck with a higher cube rate that requires me to, that but requires such snapping, I think I would say. I tend to value win rate over cube rate mostly because cube rate is so nebulous. Like, there's going to be a lot of stuff with a high cube rate because it's unknown, and a lot of stuff with a high win rate that is known that you just have to optimize your snapping for. An example would be like Thanos, right? Thanos is probably the most snap-intensive deck there is. If you are playing it properly, you're making a ton of really early snaps, and you're taking some losses when you do. And if you don't play it like that, and I gotta be honest, I don't think most people play it like that, you shouldn't be playing the deck. Because it's not a good choice unless you're doing that. And I think there's just such a, I don't know if cube rate is fake, but it's close. If you just assume cube rate is fake and never look at it, I think you'll get closer to the ballpark of what's actually good than assuming the opposite.
Glazer?
Everything that, I have one more thing to add, though. So cube rate is fake, but what isn't fake is popularity of a given deck. The other thing I look at mm-hmm. that's not just win rate, and I completely don't give a shit about cube rate at all. I spend a lot of time trying to figure out how much for the meta a deck is going to be. Like, all of a sudden, for a week there, I had to meta against Patriot again for some reason. And now, like, because it went from like 2% of the meta to like 8%. And 8% is enough percentage of games that if I'm not prepared for it, if I don't know, just like, hey, and like sometimes the 8% deck is one that I just don't care to meta against. And I'll be like, huh, Patriot, if they have it, I'm gone. Second they snap, I'm gone, right? You can do that when it's not a tournament. Galactus is like the ultimate example of this to me. But ultimately, what I care about is how much does it win and how much can I expect to see it? Like right now, I'm infinite and I don't care about climbing rank above infinite. But what I do care about when I care to win, when I care to analyze a deck, is I know I cannot play a deck right now that just loses to the Kitty Pride decks. They're everywhere. Kitty is free. So yeah. Since I can't do that, I know that like all of a sudden I'm packing like Ghost and Killmonger sometimes. Just like a two-card package. And that's suddenly why Wave is like, even though she was nerfed, I'm not sure how nerfed she was, that's a conversation for later. that's why Wave is so strong, because everyone wants to drop 18 cards on the last turn, and if they can't, their deck just goes off and you get free wins.
Right, but by the same token, right, Wave is so strong right now. What happens when the decks just, like, when they see a Zabu Darkhawk, they just start playing their shit on turn five and then just play a Chavez on the final turn and then you die, right? Like, Wave is only good as long as it's unexpected. I lost a bunch of games with Wave against bounce decks because Milano encouraged all of them to explode on turn five. It was just like, oh, this isn't actually good if they know what I'm doing. So there's also, like, you need to be backing it up with real power, or they are just going to be strong enough to go, like, you know, Mysterio Kitty Pride Hit Monkey, or Mysterio Demon Hit Monkey on turn five, and then play their 8-power Kitty Pride or their 9-power America Chavez or whatever it is. You're only playing a Dr. Doom now. Mm-hmm. Like, they can actually win those games, and, you know, I do think the Wave stuff is good in that matchup, but it's only good if they don't know your Wave.
The central tension of the game to me right now, not always, but in this current meta, is it stay ahead or is it worry about tech cards from behind? Right? And, like, identifying when you want to do either one is extremely important to me right now. Sometimes if you're ahead on turn five, there's enough cards in the game that say, I just won because I was ahead going into turn five, or I was ahead at the end of turn five. And sometimes it doesn't matter if you're ahead turn five because they're trying to counter what you're doing. And, like, being able to get ahead of that early has been extremely important in this meta.
Yeah, I think the Kitty Pride decks are unbelievably good. And the only thing that's keeping me from playing a ton of Kitty Pride decks is I really hate the Kitty Pride mirror. It's so bad. It's like, okay, who has Kitty? And then it's like, okay, do you have a second one drop to play with your kitty? Like, if I had a match the other day, it was like, I played a kitty, right? And they played a kitty. And then on turn two, I just played the kitty again. And they played kitty and Bast. And I was like, oh, I lost. They snapped and I left. It was just like, oh, well, I'm actually just dead. Like, I actually cannot catch up to that if they have any semblance of reasonable cards in their hand after that. I'm just dead.
So bring us back around to sort of general principles. So when you're trying to decide on a good deck, like, let's say you're making a meta call. How critical would you say, like, are the sort of final two card choices in a deck, right? So, like, think about what you're saying, the Kitty Pride mirror, right? Is what's critical to that the final couple of cards? Like, are you running X? Are you running Y? Like, when identifying this deck, like, how, in a game with Marvel Snap, which only has 12 no cards, idea. How would you say the sort of final couple of slots are?
That's wildly too contextual to even begin to give you a general answer to. The Kitty Pride deck specifically, I have not figured out how to beat the mirror. I'm trying, like, okay, Korg and Black Widow. I do think Korg is probably superior to Iceman in the mirror because you're kind of a velocity deck, so bricking a draw is usually a little bit better than making a one drop cost two. It's sort of my thought process, but you're also, like, kind of unlikely to brick a draw. And then it's like, okay, do we run Chavez to make sure that we draw our kitty more because that's how we think we win the mirror? Do we run Darkhawk because we're running Black Widow and Korg? I don't really know. The point is, I haven't found a way to consistently break it. Honestly, you know what I want to try? I want to try playing Killmonger and, like, Shang-Chi or something. I don't even know. Like, I am so sick of Kitty Pride. It's like, I want to try it maybe in Sarah, because Sarah can afford to play that stuff. I tried it yesterday. We're recording this on a Thursday. I tried it yesterday, and Milano was the hot location, so it was terrible. Sarah, complete garbage on Milano. But, you know, there's hope. Basically, I think there are two cards that are really important right now, and they're Killmonger and Wave. And if your opponent's smart enough, they can get around the Wave. And what I would really like to be playing right now is the deck they just obliterated, Deathwave. This is like the actual meta where we're like, this would be a good meta for Deathwave. I just want to play a Killmonger Wave deck. And now the best Killmonger Wave deck is, like, deeply medium.
There's always the Lambie Thanos that runs both. But I don't know if how consistent of an answer that is.
That is, unfortunately, the best Killmonger Wave deck. But it's still, like, whenever I play against it, it's like, okay, you played, like, five stones. But instead of actually converting, instead of, like, using those stones as resources, all you did was draw cards and then kill your stones. And it's like, I get why you have to do that for the Kitty matchup, but in every other matchup, it's just like, oh man, this is rough.
You can always just not play Killmonger in those. I try and avoid it, but
I don't think you can. I think the reason to play Thanos is that it's a Killmonger wave deck. That's so why you do it, is because you want to beat those Kitty decks by playing.
The video
Killmonger
I have
wave.
Going up tomorrow, as of people listening to this Saturday's video, is Revis did a Sarah Kitty deck that's running everything you said, like with America with and like
right.
I played it for a solid 2 hours
I
today.
Don't like America in there,
man,
but I get
Moyen.
It.
Like that. No, that yes, Revis, but though. Moyen is the one who was like, please start running America and Sarah, and like made a thing of it.
I have been an America and Sarah truther really? Forever. Okay. I used to try to run Dracula and Sarah to try to get America in there. I have been a truther forever. If I recall the math correctly, it takes you from like 75 to 80, or is it from 70 to 75?
It's 6% by turn 5.
Yeah, it's not like a huge number, but it's a significant number. And I always thought if you could use the America, it was good. But especially in this meta where I'm like, A, super cold to wave. And like maybe that's a point in favor of America, honestly, because at least she's a big body in that situation. But like I would be very tempted to, if I wanted to run like a big body and surprise people, you know, like Leader or Doom or whatever.
So
I don't really
it's
know.
That you get the better chance of Sarah, but you also get the better chance of your Angela, Bishop, Kitty stuff on curve, right? And that's smaller percentages, but it's there.
Yeah.
My fear for America right now in the meta is Rock Slide and Korg mean that you're gonna have a dead draw here or there, and then you've got a dead draw again on 6, and giving up 2 to 3 draw steps seems real bad.
Yep. It ain't good. And also, I think the thing is, I want to play Sarah because it's a Killmonger deck. And if I can play Killmonger on turn 6 and have it be just as good, I want to do that, and I want to draw Killmonger. Like, I think that's my real issue, is like, the reason I would be playing Sarah right now is because I would want to be playing the best Killmonger deck, right? And so, if I want to be playing this because it's a Killmonger deck, I want to be Killmongering as much as I can. If that's the reason I'm playing this list. I guess we go back into, like, why I play lists, right? When you think about a list and its roles, you got to come up with like, okay, what is the best thing to do this thing, right? If I think Killmonger beats Kitty Pryde, I'm like, what is the best Killmonger deck? How do I make that happen, right? And so if I think Wave beats Kitty Pryde, what is the best Wave deck? How do I make that happen, right? Like, this is all, and again, if I think maybe, you know, like when you talk about the Iron Patriot deck, I was like, all right, look, I just want to go over the top of all these mid-range Black Bolt decks that are now running Iron Lad and Cutting Enchantress, right? So if they're going to keep doing that, Enchantress is not in a lot of these decks anymore. They're playing Wave for some reason, which is actively good for your Patriot deck. I'm just going to put bigger numbers on the board. That's it. Like it's about identifying what your target is and then seeing if A, your theory works out, and B, your deck can hold up in other situations. For the record, Wobbalos Doomwave, Kitty probably bounce, and I would say the Patriot deck are the top three decks I would play right now. I don't know what my answer is going to be on Saturday, but on Thursday, right now, though, that would be my answer. I say the bounce Kitty Pryde deck, because it's a little bit easier to play around Wave with the bounce Kitty Pryde deck.
The She-Hulk just dies.
Way harder to do with the She-Hulk deck. The She-Hulk Moon Girl deck is just, it's very, very hard to play around Wave. Like, it's not impossible. It's just tough. And also, the She-Hulk Moon Girl deck is a little more dead to Killmonger because of the reliance on Sunspot. So I think generally, it's just in a little bit of a worse spot against the stuff I would be trying. And if I assume that other people are going to be trying that stuff, I want to play the one that's in a little bit of a better spot.
So thinking about then, you pick the deck, you've figured out what your target is. So what do you think is the best advice you would have for our listeners about finding consistency? Is it sort of sticking with that deck, or trying a bunch of different versions of the deck, or like how long do you sort of stay with something when you to find out if it's hitting the target?
Who would you say your listeners are?
People who are sort of either mid to low, like mid, so I'd say like 60s to low infinite people would be say what I'm immediately.
All right, then what I would say is it had. Don't even fucking worry about the deck. Don't even worry about that. Like, that is not your issue. Your issue is if you're worried about this, your issue is you don't play enough games of Marvel Snap. Your issue is you need to practice more and practice your play, not your deck. Think about why you're doing things. Think about what the purpose of that is. Think about how these things, all the things that we've talked about here, think about how your deck matches up on average. Like, what do you think would normally happen? You need to focus on getting to level zero. You need to focus on understanding the game on a base level. Because I pretty much believe that if you do that, you can get there. It really is just a function of work. And you just have to honestly try and understand that it will be a commitment. I feel like people think that people like me were just always good at this shit. And absolutely not. I wasn't even good at card games until I played like Hearthstone. I got to like rank 5. I was so excited. Not rank 5 legend, rank 5 under the old system. I was so excited. And I couldn't get past it. I was like a rank 5 person for like 2 months. I couldn't get past it. I got to like rank 1 and tilted all the way back to rank 5. And I eventually made it to legend. I was a dumpster legend guy for a while. Dumpster, 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 dumpster. I was like, oh my God, my number's going up. I didn't really think my number could actually be like a good number. I was just like, oh, we made it to like top 1,000. Wow. And eventually I was like a guy finishing in the top 200 leaderboards. Eventually I was doing that kind of stuff. When I got to Magic Arena, I was playing best of 1 because it was like, oh, come on, I can't handle best of 3. First month I played best of 3, I hit rank 1, like actual rank 1 this time. And it's just like, why was that possible? Because I spent a whole shitload of time playing and thinking about the game. it's not like this shit's magic. You get out, not necessarily 1-to-1 what you put in, but on average, you get out what you put in. And if there isn't like a magic, this deck is going to make me good. That's not how it works. You have to make you good.
So can I piggyback on an idea? And I actually would really like your take on this. Okay. So I think content creators play an important role in this. I think one of the things you can do to help you think about it is watch people play who explain what they're doing. And do you know who Jorbs is?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm familiar, but I can't say I watch his content.
This is insane, and I don't know how to explain this, except there's something cognitively that happens for me, at least. So I watch Jorbs play Slay the Spire, and I'm fine at Slay the Spire. I'm, like, good enough to beat it, but, like, at a reasonably high ascension, but I don't do it consistently. I don't find it fun. But, like, I watch his content, and then if I go play Marvel Snap, I'm a better card game player. Because, the almost mimicking of the thought process that, like, makes you good at this kind of thing is fairly consistent across games. It's why you getting good at Hearthstone leads to you being good at Magic, I think, right? I think...
I once spoke to a professional Magic the Gathering player who told me that playing aggro Paladin in Hearthstone made them better at aggro decks.
So, there've got to be a few of those people running around the Snap community that, like, just watching them play and hearing them explain things makes you better. Who do you think they are? Do you haven't, like, I'm sure there's 1,000, right? I'm not asking you to name everyone.
Yeah, I got awesome. A top 5 for you. Me.
Hey.
Me. Me. Me.
You're,
and
you're
me.
Really
no,
selling the can.
There
best
are a ton
best thing right now.
There are a ton of players who I think would be good for this. I think the first person that comes to mind for me is Lambie Series. Former Hearthstone Grandmaster. Absolutely phenomenal player. The only person who's actually good at Thanos. Moyen, if he ever streams again, which, you know, maybe. I would say... So, people that I watch tend to be, honestly, not those kind of people. A lot of the people I watch are much more, you know, memes. Like, I like when I get off stream, my brain wants to be off, you know. I don't want to do more thinking, but I would say you'd start with Lambi series. You start with Moyen. I would think maybe Braude would be a good one. Common participant in my chat. I've only been in his stream a little bit, but he goes absolutely ham. Did like a 12-hour 2 tournament stream. Revis, I think. And I'm mostly just listing off good players. You may or may not find their communication skills up to par, depending on who you are and depending on how much you're willing to invest brain wise and thinking about why did he do that. But I think like this is like a key thing. The number one thing you can do to get better at something is to do that thing, and not like to theoretically do that thing. Not like to theory craft the deck, not like to watch a streamer, not like to watch some YouTube videos, not like to think about doing that thing, to do that thing. And I just think a lot of people who want to get better at Marvel Snap want to find, sorry, I'm a meathead. I'm going to make a gym analogy here. It's like if you go on Reddit, you find all these people asking about what the optimal workout is. It doesn't fucking matter. What the optimal workout is you go to the damn gym and you do something that is hard. The point is that it's work. That's the point. That's the whole thing. If it was easy to optimize, like if you're trying to optimize the work out of it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And that's why I think a lot of people think about it like that. It's like, you don't want to optimize the work out of it. That's what makes you better. That's the thing that you do to get better.
So I don't disagree with that at all. But okay, so what happens to a lot of people and a lot of the community that we hang out with are people that are just reaching infinite, that are like 80s to 100s, right? And they're grinding like insanely, like super grinding. And they get there mostly. And they end up pretty good. But the work when you're tilting is reinforcing bad habits.
Well, yeah, don't
so,
do that.
So how do you get out of that outside of just don't do that? Because, like, my advice, it's
log
so,
off.
It's so
touch
easy.
Grass.
Like, so I'm straight up, I hate that answer. Because, like, that's so easy for me to do, and I'm a teacher, right? So, like, I know enough of, like, people's cognitive differences to know that, like, man, they can't. Like, there has to be some. There has
oh,
to
no,
be,
I can't.
There has to be
I gotta tell you, else. Like, I can't. When I get tilted, I can't log off. I can't do that shit. I go nuts. But you know what I should do? Is log off. Like, that's it. Like, there's no magic. There's a book, The Mental Game of Poker, you could maybe read. There's definitely, like, you know, sports psychology on this topic because there's millions of dollars on it in something like poker. So there's definitely stuff to read about it. So I think one thing that I took away from that book, to be clear, I'm like 40 pages in. I have it sitting next to my nightstand. Every time I tilt, I tell myself I'll read a little bit more of it. So the fact that I'm only 40 pages in is, you know, actually pretty good considering. But one of the things I've taken away from it so far is you have to go into this knowing and understanding that you are participating in a game that has variance in it. You have to understand that going in. You have to, when you start to get mad at some bullshit, you have to tell yourself, I knew this would happen. I knew this could happen. I knew there was a chance of it. I knew going in, I'm making an active decision to opt into this. And if that doesn't interest you, go play something else. Because you will torture yourself. Like, I'm serious. You will torture yourself. I have been in tilt holes before. I'm pretty good about it now, relatively speaking. But if you go back on my Discord history, you could probably find 100,000 messages in salt channels about how mad I am at Hearthstone or Magic or whatever, about how bullshit things are for me. I don't have a good answer to how to not do that anymore. You just need to accept it and get out of the magical thinking of if I do it this time, it'll be different. Because it won't. It won't be different until you are. And I guess, you know, one of the things that's changed between me and those 100,000 messages or whatever is that I'm like 7 years older now. I don't know if that might have helped. But if I had to say anything to me back then, I don't know if I could have done it. Yeah. I don't know if me now could talk me then out of being tilted. I don't think I could have done it. Maybe. But so I don't know if I could.
I think that experience is a large part of it, right? Like, Roy will back this. Like, when you go teach a lesson, you can teach the exact same lesson to two different groups of kids. And one group of kids, it's like you just gave them mana from heaven. And the other group of kids, it's like you just shat in your hand and tried to throw it at them, right? Like, there's no fucking rhyme or reason to it. It's just something about the alchemy in that room at that time, even with the exact same, like, system, made the thing not work. And, like, you do that enough days in a row, and, man, you become fairly tilt-proof. Like, it's just like, I just had a bunch of 16-year-olds look at me like I grew a third head. Like, okay.
So, yeah. I think it's one of the things that sort of makes this somewhat different in Marvel Snap is because of two things. One is, I think, because the games are designed to be shorter, there's, like, higher variance, right? Which is not saying that games like Hearthstone, I played a lot of Hearthstone, I played a lot of Magic.
Hold on, I want to push back on that. I think that's actually just 100% not true.
You don't think it's true?
No, God. Like, I people say this a lot, like, oh, there's so much variance in Marvel Snap. Like, what game are you playing? Your deck is 12 cards. What are we talking about here? In Magic, I can shuffle up for a game and then just not play.
It's true.
That can happen. Like, so I guess, first of all, randomness is fundamental to why these games are good, because if the games aren't random enough, the better player wins all the time. You need to have randomness in here or there will be no tension. It will be chess. If you want to play a game where the better player wins all the time, go lose to Magnus. All right. Go do that. If you opt into playing a card game with randomness and variance in it, the least you can do is to not beat yourself up when you're on the bad side. Like, that's the least you can do for yourself is to, like, you'll get mad or whatever, but, like, don't carry it. Do your best not to carry it with you and take it into other parts of your life. Because, like, speaking from experience, I've done that.
Yeah.
Don't do it. It's not good. When you're tilted in one thing, there is this tendency to take it and expand it outwards. And that's how you start, like, a tilt spiral in real life. Mm-hmm. That's my one piece of advice. If you're tilted, maybe not. You don't even have to log off. But do not, under any circumstances, let it escape your computer.
That's really good advice. But to double back to Snap. All right, so let's say that it's not more variance. But the snappy mechanic, I think the fact that it is different than any other card game, that at least like the mainstream ones that most of us understand, play Magic, Hearthstone, Runeterra, right? I think does create sort of points of confusion and sort of points of salt. So what advice could you have for folks to get their head around the specific dynamics that snapping creates for people and how they could feel about it if they're trying to improve their consistency and move up to the next level?
Understand that if you snap and you're wrong, it's fine. Like don't, I know people are going to be, like, emoting on you and shit. I know people are going to be, like mentally dabbing on you, and you're going to imagine everyone laughing at you. You don't have to. You don't have to do that. I had someone turn one Mindstone snap me the other day. I stayed in the game, and I won. And I felt great about it. It's like, oh, God, I got their ass. But you know what the thing is? They were right. They should have snapped there, because if you're not snapping there, you shouldn't be playing Thanos. Like, that's, you play Thanos so you can snap those hands. That's what you do. That's what the deck does. And if you are not willing to egg on your face, then you are going to consign yourself to a very slow Galactus-esque climb.
You know what helps a lot with this? Watching high-level tournaments. Because, like, those early snaps happen all the time, and good players just go. They go, you have the thing. Peace out. Thank you so much. I know that your deck is doing what it wants to, and maybe my deck can still beat it. But unless I also happen to have exactly what my deck wants to do, just peace. And why would I stay around to see?
Yeah. So one thing that my stream is actually really bad for, and I think a lot of high-level streamers are really bad for this, because they are content creators, will either stay in games or they'll not snap. Now, I do the second one a lot more. I do a lot of no snapping when I'm like clearly ahead because I want to put a game on my YouTube or whatever. I do a lot of that. And I know someone like Jeff Hoogland does that. I know that. It is undeniable that like that is a thing that is impacting you because you are a streamer providing a product, right? So yes, tournaments. Specifically, the person whose snaps I have liked the most recently is KJB. Kenny Britton, former Pokemon player, I believe. Absolutely fucking phenomenal snapping. Like, one of the things that really stuck out to me, he played against Torracoon in a almost 12 card, not a 12 card Darkhawk mirror, but like one of the things that was really important in that mirror is Zabu Rock Slide is basically just the most important thing you can do, because once they start drawing those rocks, it breaks the symmetry entirely. And also, if they don't have the Rock Slide, your Darkhawks are bigger. So it's just like turn three Rock Slide is just like the most important thing you can possibly do. And KJB was snapping every hand with turn three Rock Slide, and Tori wasn't. And I honest to God think that was the entire matchup, that KJB snapped that and Tori didn't snap it back in one of those cases. And that was literally it. And like, to be clear, they are both phenomenal players. We talked about it afterwards and Tori was like, you know, I didn't snap it back because I felt like I was still unfavored, but maybe the fact that I was unfavored is why I should have snapped it back, because he also had Zabu Rock Slide in his hand. And it was like, okay, you have to. Like, you just have to try to win that game, because otherwise you're probably going to lose most of it, right? So snap dynamics are important to understand, but it's also important to understand that snap dynamics will change in a tournament because people will evaluate matchups differently. I'll go back to another tournament example. This was Revis's Galactus list playing against Deathwave, right? And Revis had gotten to that point by aggressively snapping with Galactus, because that's how you're good at Galactus, right? That's what makes you good at winning games with tournaments with Galactus, is you snap really aggressively. But the Deathwave list had basically no answers to him. It was pretty clear, outside looking in, obviously the much easier position to do this from, that if they played a bunch of long 2-cube games, Revis would end up on top. And what ended up happening was Revis snapped aggressively, lost an 8-cuber in the first game, and then won like 3 or 4 games before actually losing his other game. And it's just like, that's... So like, snap dynamics will change based on how you evaluate your matchup. If you think you're favored playing like 15 games, then do that. If you're the underdog, drag them into variance territory. Like, this doesn't have... Again, this is just about tournament snap dynamics, but the point I'm trying to make is why it's different from ladder and why you might not be able to one-to-one it here. Because if you watch a player snapping aggressively, maybe they just think they're the underdog. So like, to go back to an NBA example, do you remember those James Harden Houston Rockets teams where the whole theory was just, when we are the worst team, we will shoot a shitload of threes? And they almost beat the KD Golden State Warriors just shooting a shitload of threes before they went like, what, 0-for-21 yep. in the final like game? But like, the point is, that strategy got them there. And they got really fucking unlucky at the end, but that strategy got them to a game 7 with the best team anyone's ever seen. And when you are the worst team, increasing the variance works in your favor. You might lose more, or you might lose...
Bigger.
Yeah, larger. But you can also increase your chances to win.
Yeah, I mean,
And so that dynamic informs tournament snapping. So don't just like take that and be like, oh yeah, I know, absolutely, I'll just do what they do in a tournament. You have to understand why they're doing it.
Yeah, I think being willing to be unlucky is, I think, something that is inherent in this sort of snap dynamic that I think is really, that you pulled out a really good job there, Cam. So I think we should transition to talking about one of the things I've really enjoyed watching your stream, which is you're really good at identifying what your opponent is playing. So what do you think is like one of the critical ways of identifying when you're on ladder in those critical early turns, what your opponent is playing, particularly if it's something like Iceman, right? Which can go into several different decks, or even Korg at this point, which doesn't necessarily guarantee that they're playing Darkhawk, or at least the Darkhawk mid-range deck. It could be the Kitty Pride deck, but it isn't quite the same as sort of the Stature deck. Like, how do you sort of identify that in those critical early turns to adjust your play?
I mean, I don't think there's any trick to that. You either know or you don't. Like, if they play a Zabu, you got a pretty good idea of like several of the other cards in the deck. If they play a Korg, you can make a reasonable guess, but you maybe don't want to make a whole determination based on that. Like, generally, the things that get me the most are things that I just am not used to playing around or just don't expect. This is why I've always kind of been a fan of Claw.
Love
Claw. No one ever plays around Claw. Ever. No one ever does it. He's not a very good card, but nobody in the history of Earth has ever played around Claw in like high elo, because why would you? Why would you play around Claw? It's just such a hard card to play around, and also no one runs it. So obviously, you know, if you do manage to like slip it into deck, the issue with the Claw is like it's kind of bad. But like that's the idea, right? It's like the same idea as like those decks that used to just run like a random Heimdall. Like doing something that's just totally off the wall is a really good way to farm cubes. If the thing you're doing is actually good.
I think Claw is good. I don't think Claw is actually bad. Like, Doom is Doom.
It's like deeply mediocre. Well, hold on. We have different definitions of good, though.
Good call. I love that. Yeah.
Like, to me, if a card is not the best possible option in its slot, that card sucks. Okay. And that holds true for decks, too. Like, why would, like, let's talk about, like, Sauron, right? Back when Shuri was popular. Sauron was a good card in that deck in the sense of the numbers. Sauron had a very high win rate because it was only played in that deck. But it made your deck worse. So it's actually fucking terrible. Like, the fact that you're still winning with it, that's fine. But you're making your deck worse. You're losing percentage points by making this swap. So it's like one of the worst things you can possibly do, right? Like, that's like... To me, when I say something sucks, I just mean like it's not number one. It's not the best option for this. And that means that if I play it, I'm throwing away value. I'm throwing percentage points out the window.
My theory for Claw is not that he obviously goes in every deck. I don't think he's ever a good stuff card. But there's... Okay, so the specific two examples I'm thinking of are if you're playing Professor X and if you're playing Sandman. I think he's good if you're playing Professor X, and like he might be closer to top in slot than we give credit for, because again, no one will ever play around him ever, and that's how you win A-cubes.
No one plays and around him. Yeah,
I think he's really, really like actually probably my single favorite five in a ramp deck, and very few people run him.
I would buy it if I wasn't running Enchantress and all my Electro Sandman decks right now.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, like I would buy it. Like, I don't like running Arrow.
Right.
I really hate it, actually. But I don't really have any better idea. Like Spider Woman, maybe. I don't really know. Like, it can't tie to Enchantress.
Everyone's running Doom right now, and I just love being like, all right, you think I'm gonna Doom too? And like, if I can do my math right, and I know you're Dooming, I just win.
Well, I mean, I'm kind of thinking like, you know, in those matchups where you don't want to play Sandman, yeah, like really against. Good. The wave deck or whatever. You go like Electro, Claw, yep. Doom, Odin.
Yeah.
Seems insane. Like, yeah. I'm with you. I think it's actually, like, it seems like it'd be really good in ramp. I just do feel like I am kind of priced into Enchantress. Because I get these, like, okay, first of all, if everyone's doing wave with Darkhawk, they have to play their Darkhawks earlier. Very good for Enchantress. Second of all, I don't like Patriot if I'm Sandman. I would like that deck to not exist, and I'd like to kill it as fast as I can. So Enchantress goes in. Third of all, you actually get to play Jeff with it. So you go like Enchantress plus Jeff on six. And it's like, oh, that's like not terrible. Like it does. It's like it would be terrible to just play Enchantress. But because you can play Jeff through Electro, it's like, OK, you know, that's like, OK, like it's not like the worst thing I've ever done. And so that all of that has added up to like. Oh yeah, I'm down with Enchantress in this list now, and so now all my Sandman lists basically are running that. And I if they weren't, I would be with you on Claw, because they're also I think like some of them are running Iron Lad too. I've been losing to a lot of Iron Lad Jubilees
Claw
lately.
Is really good. I know
it is, but what if I play my Iron Lad in my Claw lane and it pulls Enchantress?
See,
and
I cry myself
to sleep.
I gave up on Enchantress. Like, I tried it. Yeah.
I feel like I have to play her.
You're better at deck building, right?
She just sucks. I get it. But like the Iron Patriot deck is like, oh my god. And they're also cutting Cosmos right now for like waves and stuff. So like if they're gonna let me do it, I'm gonna do it. Right? Like if they're gonna be an Onslaught deck, I am gonna play the card.
Okay.
So, all right. How about playing as your opponent? So what are some tips that we might have for our listeners about sort of figuring out what your opponent might do, right? Sort of the Dr. Doom, you know, like, do you play around Doom? Do you play around Claw? Do you play around Enchantress? Like, how do you specifically identify that? Beyond just metagame knowledge. Obviously, like, I think you made a good point where you just got to know. Okay, that's awesome. I've watched Gambest stream. I go on SnapFan. I go on Untapped. I have a general sense of what the decks do. But how do you sort of lower... You understand the deck list, but there's... come down to the what maybe two or three plays that your opponent can have and which one is more sort of likely. Like, what do we have any heuristics for how, that or shortcuts? Yeah,
how much... I'm going to explain a concept that I'm stealing from some magic writer that I don't remember, but it might actually legitimately be Mike Flores. That's how old this concept is. Level zero is you play your deck optimally. That's it. Like, level zero... you play your deck optimally. You are black bolting into Stature. You are playing your Zabu, and you know you're supposed to play your Rock Slide and save your Dark Hawk so it doesn't get Enchantress. You know you're playing Wave on 5 to fuck up these kitty decks. Or if you're a kitty deck, you know what you're doing in terms of ordering your Enchantress, your Angelas and kitties, right? That's level zero. Level one is you expect your opponent to be playing waves, so you dump your hand on turn five as a kitty deck and then play a Chavez the next turn, right? That's level one. You have some idea of what you play and your opponent is doing, and you play around it and respect it, right? Level two is you're the wave deck, and you know your opponent is going to do that, so you don't even play the wave. You play just go for stats. And then you realize, okay, you know, they're going to make this play anyway and then play the Chavez. I can beat that. Right? And so... and here's the thing, though. Level three? That's the same as level... It's the same as level zero, though. Because now you're just playing all your cards on turn six and they didn't play the wave because they thought you weren't going to play all your cards on turn six. Right? They thought you were going to play around the wave, but they didn't play around the wave. Right? Like, that's... it kind of goes in a circle. And so you have to properly evaluate how good you think your opponent is and what level you think they're operating on, and then be one level above that. Because it doesn't matter if you're on level a million if it lines up such that their level zero play beats your level a million play. So you have to figure out how much respect to give your opponent. And one of the things that players like Moyen are really good at is getting that read really early. They know exactly how much to respect a given opponent, things like that. And like in playing against them, you know, I learn, okay, I have to respect them this much. So now we actually get into the real dance of like, will they, won't they? And Snap has a lot of will they, won't they situations. I like to refer to them as the wine in front of me from The Princess Bride. It's literally just that. It's literally just, but you can't play in the left lane, because if I play my Hulk in the left lane, you will never ever win. But of course, you know that I can play my Hulk in the left lane, so you will always go in the right lane, but then that means I can play my Hulk in the right. It's just that. It's just that.
I have a Zini myself with that every time. I was hoping you had some kind of secret there. Like, I can't, like, I always...
No.
Like... not always, but far too often, I'm like, well, they have to know I have Darkhawk and Rock Slide now, right? So instead, I'm going to do this thing that beats their counterplay. And then I sit there, I'm like, I just donated them 8 cubes. That was fun. Like, why would they stay in? They can clearly my Darkhawk Rock Slide.
Well, the thing is, again, like, you just have to, like, understand who you're playing against, right?
On ladder.
And a lot of people on ladder do not care. At least, as far as I can tell, no offense down there, people at my ELO care for some reason. There are dudes snapping on, like, turn two and like going absolutely. I told you I got turn two snapped, right? Just off the differential of they had Bast in the kitty mirror and I didn't. And it's like, yeah, that's correct. Fair enough. I'm leaving on turn two. Yeah, you got me. I do not think I beat that. That kind of stuff will happen. But like, I honestly feel like a lot more people need to just be playing. A, get good enough to be level zero, but B, just play on level start. One. Should be like, what's the obvious thing they're gonna do here? They're probably doing that.
Like, it's completely ridiculous how many games I lose that way. Like, complete, like, where I'm just like, why you can't? If you're staying in, you here's my obvious play, and you obviously are going to. It's so annoying. It's like one of my least favorite things about wherever the hell I am in my ELO, which I have no idea, right? But like.
I mean, the other thing is you just kind of have to, like, if you have a play that wins against, like, 95% of things they do, you need to have a really hard read that they're doing something other than that. Like, my play loses if they play Dr. Doom in their lockdown deck. But, like, if you're talking about, like, combinations of cards here, like, specific combinations of cards you don't even know they run, sometimes you just got to tell you, like, all right, show me. Prove it. Prove you have this. I don't believe that you have this. Like, you not only have to calculate, like, what can beat you, but how likely it is that they have it. And then you factor that in, too. Like, if you're talking about, like, oh, I lose to a Shang-Chi, sure, outthink yourself, right? Shang-Chi creates a lot of these situations. But if you're talking about, like, I lose to them specifically guessing where I play my Darkhawk, yeah, I'll roll those dice, dude.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about largely, it's like the Shang Enchantress, the Killmonger when I've got, like, some higher cost things, but more one cost things will whip. Like, the few extra of those, it's those matchups that are incredibly frustrating for me.
It's why Sarah actually is a higher cube rate deck. Like that's one of the few decks I actually believe in cube rate with, is because the range of crap they can do on turn six is so large. There's like basically an infinite amount of garbage that can happen in
Thanos
a Sarah matchup.
Does that too, where like there's just so many different varieties, one or two cards, and they draw so many wildly different things.
Yes.
So just this is slightly off topic, but like, so I was playing the deck that came from your Discord, the one that became known as KM Thanos, that deck, and I did. That's what everyone called it for a while. Yeah. So the original one that got nerfed to oblivion with I was playing that just randomly like in a little Discord channel, and Tori wandered in and explained how to play the deck properly in like 5 minutes, and I just like immediately went to infinite. I was like, thanks. It's like.
Yeah, you gotta snap your broken hands.
Yeah,
that's pretty much it, right? You got Mind Stone. You probably just snap
it. It was basically, do you have Mind Stone, do you have Lockjaw, or do you have Quinjet? Any of the three, snap, have a great time. You're gonna win enough of your games.
Yeah, you just snap on any of them because they're all broken. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
I was just picking up a random deck. I was like,
Thanos especially is like, it's why Lambie is so good at the deck, because he has more reps on it than anyone. And again, like we talk about this like it's magic, right? Lambie series, Hearthstone Grandmaster, of course he's good at Thanos. No, he played more Thanos than you. Like that's, it's very, very incredibly smart dude. Also put in so much work. You don't become the Thanos guy by not playing the card.
That's a fair point.
It's very true. So, Cam, we only have a few more minutes with you, I believe. So, I want to sort of give you a chance to give our listeners sort of one big final takeaway. If you're looking to sort of level up your game, what is sort of the big takeaway from our discussion here that you would like our listeners to have? Sort of the TLDR of the last sort of hour of their lives.
Subscribe to this podcast. Subscribe to Cam Best.
Hey, we just got our second short.
TLDR. honestly, TLDR. B be kind to yourself and afford yourself the same kindness you would afford to others. I think a lot of people, myself included, judge themselves more harshly than they judge others. Like, someone came into your Discord and was like, yo, I finished rank 85 and I'm trying to improve. Would you actually be like, that person sucks? I don't think a lot of people would. Now, would people be like right to maybe think, you know, your opinion is less relevant in like super high level meta discussions? Yeah, maybe. But that doesn't mean that you're consigned to it. You know what I mean? Like, you are more than your rank and you always have the ability to improve.
That rank 85 thing. Are you a baseball fan at all? All right, cool. Enough so to get an Joe analogy. Morgan was, you know who Joe Morgan is? Do you remember Joe Morgan? Okay, Joe Morgan is arguably the best second baseman ever. He was on the Big Red Machine Reds.
The one from the Reds, right? What do you mean, do I remember Joe? That's the 1960s.
So you might remember Joe Morgan as an ESPN announcer. So Joe Morgan was so successful because he walked and hit a lot of power for a second baseman. He didn't get caught stealing. He did all the, like, sabermetrics-y things that make you good at baseball. So 25 years later, yes. Joe Morgan, the greatest second baseman ever, perhaps, because he did these things, becomes an announcer right at the start of the, like, sabermetric revolution. And all he kept telling everybody was that David Eckstein was the best baseball player ever. That he was, like, because he bunted, because he hit for a lot of singles, but didn't have any power, like, was so great. Meanwhile, these big sluggers who were good in fundamentally the same way that he was were overrated and bad. He had a fundamental misconception about what made him special. And it, like, filtered through. And obviously, that's, like, an extreme example. But, like, Greg Popovich was never going to be an NBA player, right? Like, he was never going to have the ability, the physical, whatever. But he's also the greatest coach ever. He has the greatest or close enough for argument's sake, right? He has the greatest understanding of how to motivate people, what strategies to use, when to use those strategies, how to play different styles, so on and so forth. I think one of the fundamental misconceptions we have as people is that being good at something automatically grants you an expertise. I think metacognition is much more complicated than just being good at something. I think the reps can get you good, but I don't think they automatically make you more metacognitive and able to transfer that skill. What's always impressed me about you...
Skill is the important bit, right? It doesn't make you a better teacher, right? Like, Barry Bonds can't teach anyone to hit like Barry Bonds because Barry Bonds is the only person who could. And because steroids are illegal now. But, like, it's hard. It's rare to see someone who is truly great on the court be able to convey that knowledge across most sports. Like, when you think of, like, great players that became great coaches, kind of just Bill Russell.
Yeah.
Like, it's actually pretty hard to think of someone who was great and, like, stayed great. Off the court, it's pretty difficult. And
if they did, it was for, like 2 years.
Especially, like, you look at...
Like, Bird was really good for, like, two years, but he burnt out because he was too insanely competitive.
Like, he was a fairly mediocre executive, though. Like, you look at MJ, right? Like, MJ is just the worst executive in the league. And, like, that's not fair. No, there's, like, so many bad NBA owners.
I know. As someone who grew up in Washington,
really not,
he was,
man.
With the Wizards, like he was bad. Like,
he's really not. He's really not the worst. It's, like, if I had to give somebody the worst NBA owner, the new guy in Phoenix.
Yeah, but it's been Matt 2 weeks. Like, someone with a real sample size.
It's been 2 weeks, but also, he interfered with an actual game on the court, got a technical on the opposing player, fired the coach, and then had Woj take the part where in his article about firing the coach where it said Matt Ishbia has taken control over basketball operations in Phoenix, he had Woj take that part out of his article, which is just a really good sign when you know that your involvement is something that will be unpopular. Related, Matt Ishbia has taken control over Woj's editorial duty.
So, I always forget his name, but my least favorite are the Magic owners for political reasons. That's the Davos family. But
Oh, God, yeah, the Amway like people? Christ, yes.
But my least favorite owner.
Yes, related to Eric Prince. I am very aware of what you mean.
Yeah, he was like, all right, he's like, I could compete if I just bought this brand new team that's like ready to win a title if I just do like these three minor things, like go a little bit into the luxury tax extra. And they're like, no, how about we tear it down? Let's just be like the worst run team for the next 7 years and get bailed out because James Harden.
They're big in the UFC too, right? I've always heard rumors that they were like, you know, connected, quote unquote. In those ways. So, you know, I'm sure they're all terrible people. Like, they're too rich to not be terrible.
They are billionaires.
Like, that's just how it is. It's impossible. It's impossible to be like
the best part of these conversations is they weed out the listeners I don't want.
All right. So
Roy's going to close us out at that thought.
I am going to close us out at that thought. All right. So, Cam, real quick, one more time, tell our loyal listeners where they can find you.
KMBestMS on Twitch and Twitter, KMBest in a snap on YouTube. Twitch, I stream every day except for Mondays and Thursdays. So that's Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 6 p.m. Eastern every one of those days. That is my current schedule because for some insane reason, I also have a real job. And those are the worst days during the week for me. So if I kept forcing myself to stream, I was probably going to have my eyes explode on those days. So I have managed to make this schedule work. That is generally where I'm at. I will continue to try to juggle these two things as best I can. YouTube content goes up fairly regularly. It's going to be like basically no more than 2 days between videos at this point, and mostly it'll be like, you know, every day, every other day. It's deck guides, how to improve, but in a more direct sense, right? Like, it's not like I'm digging into theoretical things on the YouTube, really. I am telling you, like, hey, this is a deck. I'm interviewing the person who built it. Let's talk about how you get better at this deck. Let's talk about what all the card choices are. Let's talk about what you can take out, what you can put in, things like that.
Awesome. Well, thank you for being with us this evening, and we hope to have you on soon, on again soon.
Awesome. It's been a pleasure. I genuinely enjoyed this a ton, and I'm sorry for derailing your podcast by talking about James Harden.
We do anyway. Like, are you kidding? Like, we are the rambliest thing in the world, but thank you so much. This was amazing.
All right. Well, this segment is going to be, I don't think, quite as informative as the last one, but Glazer and I are going to dig in now on the patch. All right. So there's been like a lot of, well, there's been two patches, I guess, since we last did an episode. So there's the over the air changes to Enchantress, Venom, Rock Slide, and Drax. I think these kind of changes are sort of like played out at the point in which people will be listening to them. But Glazer, overall, what would you say are sort of the big, big picture takeaways for sort of these changes?
Brains are funny. Venom's getting played a lot, and like he's really a solid card in the meta. But like he's getting played in decks where he's 20 power and 25 power. So like the +2 didn't freaking matter there in any way, shape, or form. So these decks could have existed. We just didn't think of it until they made him shiny. That's my main takeaway. Like, Drax is fine. Like, I'd probably rather run Crossbones, but Drax is fine.
I did lose to a Drax the other day.
Fair. But yeah, me too, actually. Because everyone had to play Guardians because of the stupid, weird choice they made to have the Star-Lord thing. Enchantress is great. And that whole Rock Slide on 3 thing, we're going to actually talk about this a lot. Safety Blade is our guest next week. Safety Blade is one of my favorite people in the game. And like our current conversation we keep having, I had this while I was streaming the SnapFan tournament, is that certain cards have an invisible power that we never talk about or think about. And that whole you draw, like I put 2 rocks in your deck, especially on turn 3, doesn't guarantee, but makes it extremely likely that you're going to draw at least one. And now I've drawn a card more than you, and if I draw a card more than you, and especially if you're running America, because now I'm drawing 2 cards more than you, I'm gonna win that game so much more of the time, and I should be snapping. And like that invisible power of Rock Slide, because you never know that they drew the rock for sure, right? Unless they drop it for some reason, is crazy. Roy, you're muted.
I do love it when they play the rock. It makes me feel good.
But like that rock slide. Rock slide is one of the more underrated cards in the game, and I think that's one of the secret powers of that deck that no one really thinks about or talks about.
Absolutely. I'm happy for our podcast that we said that Enchantress's buff was good, but was probably going to go one point down. And I was like, when I opened my little like notifications and it said that, I was like, called it. Called it on the show. I love being correct. That's my favorite. That's where I get my real endorphins. I think to get back to your point, though, about Venom, I think it's actually really important that they change Venom, because sometimes cards could be okay, but you have to call attention to them, right? And it was like a lot of space. And I really do hope that happens to some other cards. Some other cards that probably are in the range of playability, but they need some attention drawn to them. Like, I think for me, Baron Mordo is a really important, as a card that could get targeted for this, because I think it's a card that has an interesting effect that people might want to play, but needs something that calls players' attention to him that he doesn't currently have.
Quake is the card. They said earlier that they might get rid of the central location restriction on Quake. The second they do that, I'm going to become Keen Koala. I'm just going to play Quake constantly.
I mean, okay, well, that's a pretty big change. There's some good Quake variants out there, too.
Quake's so
some really ugly ones,
Quake
too.
Is so
My sister might start playing Marvel Snap if Quake becomes a good card, because, woo, does she love the Quake from the TV show? Yes. Anyway... patch. All right, let's really dig in though with the new patch. I mean, we talked already a lot with KM about Kitty Pride decks, but the biggest change I think from the patch is sitting here on Thursday, of course. You'll probably be listening to this on Friday, maybe Saturday, is that is Kitty herself. So Glazer, now that you've finally got Miss Pride in your hand, Shadow Cat. Sort of like, how impactful do you think Kitty has become on the meta? And that everyone has her, to be clear.
Everyone who didn't make their account yesterday. Then she's 5,000 tokens. 6,000 tokens, excuse me.
Is that really?
Yeah, she gets trapped into Series 5 if you make your account after she was given for free. I think it's hilarious as well. It's a dumb decision. Just give everyone Kitty Pride. I'm going to... just say straight up,
wow, that is a choice.
I didn't think Kitty was going to be as good after the nerf, and I was just wrong. After she was re-released because of the change, and I was wrong. I think she's the best one drop in the game, and I don't think it's close. I think Nebula is still excellent. I think Iceman is still excellent. I think Korg is severely underrated, and I think Sunspot remains really good, and I think Kitty blows them out of the water. She is both a fit in and a build around.
Yeah, I think it's really one of the things that's really interesting about Kitty discourse to me is that how it just immediately stomped on Nebula discourse.
It kills Nebula. You can just drop her in the Nebula spot every turn. And
I agree. I'm just saying that it's sort of this card was really under discussed. I mean, I include ourselves in this. It was sort of like announced that she was going to be free. Everybody's like, yay, free card. Well, apparently only free for those of us who were playing before the 12th. Was that the beginning of the week?
I don't know.
Time has only specific days have meaning. Dates have no meaning to me at this point where I am. But and I just am super interested to sort of see where she goes going forward, because I think that Kitty could easily be the most broken card that has existed since top Silver Surfer, top sort of Zabu, just simply because she breaks sort of how the game functions and forces you to play in a way that I think no other card really since Silver Surfer has caused you to sort of play the game and think about things. And I think that makes her a really cool card. But I wonder how long it is before she gets hit with the nerf stick. But we're done with over the air nerfs and buffs, at least in the short term, right?
No, there's one more. Yeah, next one Thursday. More.
So practically done, but almost done. But we're not, June is not getting them, I believe, is basically what they said.
Implied.
So maybe July it could pick up again. That brings us to sort of, what's the best way to put this? Some of the less popular decisions that second dinner made this week that we are coming out late enough in the week that sort of the wave of the discourse has sort of already crested through the community. So we'll spend a little bit of time talking about, but not the focus. So the big one is that Master Mold, Nimrod, and Negasonic are Series 5 cards that are not the big bets.
There's Series 4.
That are not the big bets. Series 4. Well, you've said...
No, they move from 5 to 4.
5 to 4. Okay. That's not...
Sorry. Yeah. They move from 5 to 4.
Sorry. They move the 5 from 4. I apologize. That's on me. I misread what Aaron is saying there. And then Sentry, Silver Surfer, Dazzler, Shadow King, and Sauron are moved to just straight to Series 3, no matter where they were before. And all of that is good. Like, some of it was expected. It's sort of happy to already see, like, Surfer down in Series 3. Really cool. But the big controversial decision was that Null and Darkhawk were not moved to Series 3, which under the previously not announced but assumed schedule, they should have moved into Series 3 when this patch came out. And this, of course, caused a huge uproar in the community. One of the bigger ones that has happened in sort of my time playing. How do we want to take at this? Do you want to just sort of do that first and then talk a little bit more about the practical side of this?
Yeah.
Or do you want to do the practical side and then...
Let's do the big picture. And then we'll talk about the actual specific cards. So, okay. I am of two minds. I think the biggest problem with this decision is ultimately that they didn't announce it in advance. I don't think this is a terrible decision, although I wish they hadn't chosen arguably the two most powerful cards. Surfer's more powerful than Null, but whatever. Arguably the two most powerful cards to do it with, because it's a terrible...
I would say desirable is probably the right way to put it.
But that's it.
Because it covers Darkhawk is powerful, and people just like Null. Null is a design that people want to have.
So that's a really bad look to leave them there. I think the reason they left them is not what people are assuming. I think the reason is actually that they wanted us to try and find all these other cool decks. And they knew if they put Null down, then it's just everyone goes, woo, Galactus. I buy Galactus. I have Null. Great. Let's play that. And that was already sort of like the most popular deck in the meta. And that the other most popular deck in the meta was that Darkhawk deck. And they're saying, how about we make that a little harder to grab for now and you have to play other things and maybe we can shake that out of the meta a touch. And I think they actually succeeded because Darkhawk is still really, really strong, right? But you heard our conversation with Cam. It's no longer the meta. He doesn't even have it in his top three decks anymore. So given both of those cases, I think the decision was good but better announced. I think their big problem here is twofold, communication and optics. But I think in the long term, the way they're doing this is really interesting and ultimately going to lead to a positive for the game. I think it's better that it's not predictable. It's better that like we're not optimizing this and like being like, you shouldn't do that. That's wrong. Don't go buy X, Y, or Z at this point. Like not knowing that and having like that look, it's going to feel really bad if like a week ago you bought, I don't know, Sauron, right? Or whichever one was pool 5 that dropped to pool 3. And then all of a sudden, it's pool 3 like a couple days later. That's always going to feel bad. But given the way they did it, it should also almost always be fairly obvious when it's a possibility.
I agree with sort of some of the things that you're saying here. I think communication is the big one. For me, I think they should have just followed their original intentions and then announced this new system. But I think fundamentally, this is saying you need to spend your tokens. And it's kind of in many ways declaring war on the culture that rose around sort of like token spending in Marvel Snap. You know, this like, and you mentioned it, like this discourse around like optimal. The first thing you should do is buy Galactus, Thanos, etc. with your tokens. And then buy the most broken Series 5. And then everything else you should wait until it drops to Series 3. And this created sort of a perception that... And some with a lot of truth to it, that like there were not enough new cards and that new cards were inaccessible, right? And you even saw a prominent sort of like semi-Snap sort of community members or people who have stream Snap, who do Snap content before, who don't anymore, like Brian Kibler, sort of a big name that did this, who was like really criticizing them for sort of how inaccessible new cards were. So this is trying to like force people to get new cards. Right, to spend their tokens, right? And in many ways, that is a good thing. I think overall, I do prefer a world where people are spending their tokens versus this like kind of tedious discourse over like optimization, where people are like, you know, this like Protestant work ethic, like just nonsense about when it comes to fun. That I really enjoyed Bootman's videos about these. And when we had Boot on it, he did a really good job of explaining it. You can go back to that episode. You can go back and watch Bootman's episode about this. Like, that's not really the best way to approach games. Now, of course, everyone can approach a game the way they want, but I think there were other approaches that were very marginalized about sort of like spend it on the cards that bring you joy, whether that's Jeff or Howard the Duck or Darkhawk. I think Second Dinner is basically saying, yeah, we agree with that, and we're going to sort of make it obvious. And then Cam Best made a really good point in his video about this, where he talked about that actually by putting some things at Series 4, it actually makes them more accessible than the sort of mostly random, right? It's mostly random how you get Series 3 cards. Right. And it's very, and even with this, like, you select one of your series, like the Series 3 once a month. And then soon they're going to be introducing that the new shop that lets you spend 1,000 tokens to get a card. That's all very random. Some of it is baked fundamentally into Marvel Snap's design, the loot boxes, but some of it is thought that they continue to add. So Series 3 is very random. But if Darkhawk is sort of permanently Series 4, you can probably, in a week, like, you decide you want Darkhawk, he will show up in your shop at some point in that week, and you can just buy him, and you've got it. Like, you don't have to jump through many hoops once you have the 3,000 tokens. The same is true for Null. Like, you've got all the other Galactus points, boom, you can get him in a way that you wouldn't necessarily get it with Series 3. So it's win-win for Second Dinner, which is that they force tokens out of people's pockets, which they want. They want you spending your tokens, and they want them to become more scarce within players' hands. But it also makes the card more accessible to people because it's like easier and faster to go. Because I can just not imagine that you're, say, Series 75, Series 3 complete, 60% Series 3 complete with all these cards dumped into there, and including Darkhawk. Like, there is no timeline on when you would get Darkhawk, right? You could get really lucky and pull him in your next cache, or he could be your last cache, like freaking Destroyer was, like my second to last cache, when all I wanted was, like, I didn't get to play Destroyer the whole time. That was one of the best decks in the meta early on in the game, because I just never had access to him, just by sheer random luck. So,
you know who's been arguing this in their content for about 2 months exactly?
Who?
Me.
Who?
Yeah.
You?
Okay. It's in like Token Shop Buyer Guide and a few other videos where I'm just like, hey, if you really want this card in your early pool 3, buy it before it drops to pool 3. Buy it in pool 4. Spend the extra tokens. Otherwise, it's either your A1 card and then you're like missing Sarah or Patriot or something, right? Like, and you would, if you would like one of those, right? Like, you can never buy those for tokens at this point. So, like, spend the freaking tokens. It's the right choice. But we've got to also talk about, as we're talking about this, the other big news regarding tokens, because that's ultimately what this conversation is about, how we spend our tokens and what they're doing with tokens. The other big news is that for June, they're only releasing one Series 5 card. The other two June cards are going to go straight to Series 4.
And they haven't said which one is which.
Yeah, everyone's assuming so Spider-Man 2099.
Is 5. It's 5. Right? Mm-hmm. It's
5. But I'm not even sure. I mean, he's the best one, but it's the coolest. It's the like splashiest effect.
Well, he's also one of the face characters of Spider-Verse. Right.
So there's Spider-Man 2099. Silk and Spider-Ham, and two of them will be released into Series 4, which means half price. They also have weekend missions, and I'm just going to say what they are. We'll talk about the other elements of this after. Let's focus on the tokens for now still. But just for playing, winning games on the weekends, you'll get credits. For winning games with the Season Pass card on the weekends, you'll get gold. And for winning games with a new release that weekend, you'll get tokens, and they're considering this like a rebate on the tokens you use to buy those cards. And like, if some of the cards are starting at 3,000, that's suddenly, like, assuming that there's any substantial amount of tokens, if you can get up to say 500 tokens, that's a real rebate. Like, if you can get up to 1,000, it's a crazy good rebate, right? But like, if you can get up to 500, that's a real rebate. Like, that's real time and money back. And I'm like, and they claim that this is only the first of other ways they're playing. Free-to-play ways, free-ish to play ways, they're planning on putting tokens into players' hands because they have removed tokens from all upcoming bundles except for Token Tuesday. There's no bundle coming that has tokens except for Token Tuesday.
Which is interesting. Which,
right, so...
which is probably why tomorrow I'm going to buy the collector bundle just to sort of make sure that I have...
I currently have enough for High Evo and then all three June cards. So if I really end up wanting Tribunal, it's going to be sad. But, like, I think that they're basically saying free-to-play players choose either two slightly less splashy Series 4 cards or one big Series 5 card, right?
See, where I'll disagree with you is I don't necessarily think splashy. I think splashiness is not necessarily the right thing, right? Because, like, Darkhawk, again, very splashy, mm-hmm. right? Spider Ham is a splashy card, right?
Just not compared to Miles. Not 2099.
But I think it's more going to be sort of... I think it's over time we're going to see, like... I think there's going to be, in some ways, less clear distinction between what's in Series 5 and what's in Series 4. I think once they finish this, like, promotion thing... Because I actually... What's going to happen is, yes, the face cards... like Spider-Man 2099, he'll always go to Series 5. But I think also the bad cards will go to Series 5. Like, I think the future Master Molds are going to go to Series 5 and then drop to Series 3, like, very quickly. I think that, like, a bunch of, like, the next sort of swing, we're talking about, like, clear swings that Second Dinner does are going to spend very little time as expensive cards. That's my sort of.
I'm not really worried about that yet. I think that these are all long term positives. These put more cards in more players' hands. And if I were them, once every 2 or 3 months, I'd do Kitty. I'd release a Kitty.
They won't.
I'm aware, but they should. Like, just give people an influx of cards, and the complaining just sort of evaporates. Like, a lot of the complaining day one and two right after the patch has sort of disappeared, as people are like, huh, what can I do with Negasonic? What can I do with Ghost? What can I do with Sauron Venom? And, like, now we're getting all these really cool builds. Safety came up with, like, just because I made him, like, he's a genius. Safety, like if I'm ever big enough to, like, get something trending on Twitter, it's going to be Safety Blade is a genius. He came up with this, like, ghost priority list that's just completely phenomenal. Like, it wins, like, it's super hard to play, but, like, it wins at, like, a top dex rate with a top dex cube rate. Not that it's super managed, but, like, the deck is great. And, like, it's just, like, no one had really tried to brew with Ghost. Like, it's sitting there and thinking about where these cards go. Combat Marvel Snap over on YouTube hits infinite with Negasonic every single season. Just goes, here's what this card wants to do. How do I build around that? And when only, like, whatever X tiny percentage of them bought that for 6,000 tokens, those cards are fundamentally invisible. Stature is the most obvious and flashy example of this, right? Right now, when we talk about it, Master Mold will be another example of this. Pulling these cards down makes the game more interesting by a lot, and it shuts up a lot of complaints that are otherwise deafening and honestly kind of depressing.
All right, so I think we've talked sort of through most of the issues around this patch, but let's talk about specifically the sort of buffs and nerfs. I actually think in some ways there aren't any nerfs in this patch. We'll start with sort of Wave. So Wave has now been made that her cost reduction is just locked. It does not matter if God himself said that you are lowering the cost of this card.
Wait. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. I don't want to jump to Wave. I want to talk about a couple of cards that are downgrading and what they do. Okay. Sorry. Real fast.
It's okay. I'm just trying to move
us forward. I get it. So I'm going to shoot, and then you spin on any of this you give a shit about. The sure. Master Mold Ronin deck that is now accessible is a tier one deck. If you like
cool
Devil
deck.
Dino decks, you should totally play it. Dara's list is basically perfect. You can arguably change Mystique, but probably just don't. The Negasonic has a couple good decks, nothing fancy. Nimrod, you should already have. Stop being cheap. Buy season passes if you at all can. And if you can't, join our giveaway. We're announcing it Monday. Century, we've talked about. Dazzler is still terrible. You're never going to convince me otherwise. Surfer is tier one, and if you joined late, go find Surfer. There's a million pool three only Surfer decks that are absolutely phenomenal. Shadow King and Ghost have a place in the meta right now because of Kitty. I'm not sure how long that place lasts, but it exists. And Sauron has some cool things. Not necessarily a great card, but is at least cool.
Yeah. All right, back to Wave.
Sorry, go Wave.
So Wave locks her cost reduction. All cards cost four. It doesn't matter if God himself, the Living Tribunal, the one who remains, whatever, says that the card is going to reduce. It's not. It's going to be cost four. From my point of view, this is not really a buff or a nerf. It is just a functionality change to, well, yes, it does kill the decks that relied on She-Hulk and Death, reducing them easily to zero. That's true. But I think Wave is still just as powerful a card. It's just powerful in not necessarily different ways, but it sort of extenuates sort of the ways in which certain things were powerful about it. First, as a ramp card, a sort of substitute for Electro, which that was already a case, doesn't matter which version of Wave you're playing, but also just as a lock piece, right, that we've talked a lot about, of the ability to stop Kitty Pryde decks, to stop Bounce decks, and to sort of, you know, and for Sandman decks and things like this, that just consistently sort of allow you to provide that lock piece. That lock piece is much stronger in the mirror, and I think really makes She-Hulk a much worse card. So I think while this is a functionality change, I think in net power level, it is at least she stays about the same power level or she's buffed. I don't think that it's a power level decrease. I think it does kill some decks, but I think on just raw rate, she's still one of the most powerful cards in Marvel Snap. And a desirable card.
Wave is great. It's meta. I don't know if it's meta forever. So, like, I don't know. Oh, is Moyen. Moyen came up with the answer, right, to Wave and Sandman and shit like that becoming meta. It's Patriot. So, no one's, or not, like, we've got a real rock, paper, scissory meta. Like, those Patriot decks just don't go quite tall enough to stand up to the Kitty decks unless those Patriot decks can figure out how to run Wave, in which case something's going to need a nerf. And I believe Lambie just posted earlier today, as of this recording, a Patriot deck that runs Wave because he is a mean, mean man.
The next sort of major change is Crystal, who got a complete redesign. She now draws you and your opponent a card. Aaron, what do you think about this card?
She's a Galactus card. I think she's a Galactus card.
Yeah.
Like, if you're...
She's a combo card.
Right, right, right.
Is what she is.
Yes, but, like, the only real combo in the game right now, I believe, is Galactus. So, like, you need to see Galactus or whatever other Galactus piece, right? You can play Electro, and if you'd like, you can play Doc Ock, right? But if you don't have Galactus, Doc Ock is often a weird play. And then you just go, all right, cool, Crystal. And then you go, huh, I don't give a shit what you drew. If I drew my Galactus, I'm happy, and I can make my next play.
Yeah, I think she's good in, like, the Nimrod versions that can Galactus on six.
She's also conceivably good in negative.
She is conceivably good in negative. I just think she's going to be a card that is this sort of bit player in combo decks, which is definitely better than
unplayable,
not played.
Yeah,
that she was before. So great, good buff, good redesign. These symmetrical draw effects are always really cool, and they sort of teach players about card advantage. So I think she's just an card economy and tempo. So all around great design. All right, Death, same card. No longer besties with Wave, which means that they reduced her cost to 8, with the hope of trying to make sort of the much fabled, honest destroy decks a real thing. Does she make honest destroy decks a real thing at 8?
I have no idea. I've played her in a couple of things. She's fun. She's also still got a home in Hela. She was not affected in Hela. I think that's a relevant note.
Well, yes.
Look, Hela's not terrible.
She could cost 5,000 in Hela.
That's fair. They are never playing her. But Elite House's build is good. So, like, not great, and it's not my style, but it's good. So, I don't know. I think that they're eventually going to do something that's going to push the Destroy package over the top again. And the Venom buff makes it at least playable. Like, I think it's, like, for using our tier list terms, like a C+, borderline B- deck. It's probably the Deadpool deck at this point, right? And I've got, like, a bounce version of it. And it's fun. Is it my favorite thing that's ever happened in Marvel Snap? No. Like, it's no longer one of the better cards, one of the first things you should buy. But it's playable and it's decent.
Yeah. I mean, that's the main issue for me. And then this has nothing to do with the specific design anymore. Just the cards, thanks to Wave's functionality change. She's just not as good of a card because you just can't cheat her into play this in the same ways. You can, obviously, with Hela, some Ghost Rider things, you know. But other than that, like, she's fine. I think that I would be imagined, think about what Marvel movie that's coming out, Destroy fits. Mm-hmm. And then we'll get Destroy cards for that. Probably won't be the Miss Marvel season, which is coming in this fall, but maybe something else.
I mean, the X-Men season might help, right? Because Phoenix is 5/5/5/5.
Does she destroy the card?
No, she brings back.
No, it's the card that brings back.
She brings back a destroyed card, adds its power to it, and then can move once per turn, right? And then so 5/17. 17 that could move around would be pretty nice. Although, obviously, you have to figure out a freaking way to destroy her.
Do you get the on reveal?
I would assume so.
With the Phoenix?
Yeah, I would assume so.
That is a good card in Hela. Because it can also mean, if you discarded your Hela, there's a chance you can get her back. So big picture takeaways of this patch, Glazer. Would you say that this patch is a success, a failure, what have you?
Long-term success, short-term failure, and very short-term failure. I think the extent to which they pissed off the community cannot be overlooked. I was mad. I opened null. I had 11 or 12. I don't really save up like that, but I had 11 or 12 collector's caches, whatever they're called, saved up. Mm-hmm. And I opened null, and because I had to open it with my series 4 and not just, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Get it for free, which is why I had been saving up, genuinely made me angry to open the card. And you don't want to make me, I don't open enough cards anymore that I should be, you want your player base feeling angry that this happens, but I did. And that's not a good look. But assuming they can get past it, I think that they're making more cards more accessible. For free-to-play players, saying once your Series 3 complete, you get one new card a month is not an acceptable rate. And that's what they were saying before this, right? You get one, maybe two, if you happen to open one new card a month. And that's, not enough. So they have to up that to at least two or three if they want this to remain healthy. Which means that whales are going to be able to affordably buy everything. And, cool, thanks. Sounds good. That's a good place for the game to be.
Okay, well, my sort of follow-up question is, what do you think is the state? This is a huge change. What do you think is the state of the game right now? I'm not just talking about the meta. I'm talking about the meta, the community, second dinner. What do you say?
There's 1,000 doom and gloomers, and, I don't buy it. I don't think people that complain generally stop playing.
They do eventually.
Eventually. But I don't think we're near that point yet, right? I think it's when people just kind of shrug and move on that, we're at a real problem. And a few people, on, the SnapFan Discord quit. But, they were largely free-to-play. A couple free-to-play players,
We need those.
Yes, 100%.
Those too.
But, they were invested players, right? But they were also, always... No offense, man. I'm not actually trying to be rude. The loudest complainers. And, I get it. I really do. I'm worried that eventually they're going to chase away anyone who's not willing to give them $10 a month. But...
Yeah, that's completely fair.
But I don't think we're particularly close to that. And I think that, So they're trying an entirely new distribution model right now, right? Like, they're trying to figure out how to sort of mix loot boxes and like all these other ideas, right, with how they do card acquisition. And like, because they're making up something totally new, there's missteps. And as long as they keep iterating on that, and like, if they could figure out how to communicate in those iterations, I think we'll be okay. You?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, for me, I think Marvel Snap design is getting better. I think the cards are getting cooler. I would like to see some more varied play experiences getting pushed by cards in the future. I think sort of giving new move tricks is really cool, and I'm excited for the Spider-Man season. I'm excited for the upcoming Jean Grey season with Phoenix and other cards like that. So I'm hoping that they sort of push like new like ways to sort of like play decks in Marvel Snap. Because I kind of think that the original sort of like core design space, the sort of maybe you could say mid-range design space in the game, is kind of played out right now, at least for me as a player. Like, I don't, like, some of those good decks I do enjoy playing, some of them I enjoy playing against, but like, they're just not very interesting to me. They don't make wanting to playing them does not drive me to play the game. Like, I want more sort of interesting, dynamic, sort of different ways to play the game besides Galactus. I really enjoy Galactus, but I would like more Galactus-like experiences. They don't have to be as extreme as Galactus, but they definitely, I think, need to introduce more of them. I agree with your thing about communication. But I want to say, like, I think the design team is getting better. I was really impressed consistently with their approaches to budget buffs and nerfs. I thought their explanations were on point. I think that they are tightening up their design process, and in a way that I think is really interesting, and I think is going to... My fear for Marvel Snap overall, and this happens with like a lot of these digital card games, is that the design gets really better over time, but by the time they figure out how to make the designs like really good, the game has gone through its adolescence and shed a lot of players. So my hope is that as they get on stronger and stronger footing, they're also able to communicate better, and they're also able to sort of square the circle when it comes to the sort of ability of free-to-play players and whales and dolphins like you and I to be able to play the game and enjoy it, which I think is a little out of whack right now. And I'm hopeful that in the coming months that they'll be able to fix it.
I'm fine with all that. Are you buying High Evo? Because it seems like the kind of thing you would like.
I am buying High Evo. Yeah, I'm really excited.
Are you also buying Tribunal?
I'm leaning towards buying Tribunal. Tribunal is probably going to get me to watch YouTube and Twitch more than I normally do on a card release. Because I was like, I'm really interested to see if Living Tribunal is cool and works. So I'll be watching Hoogland, who, for better or for worse, is very good about playing like the new cards right away. Our friend TLSG, am I saying that right?
TLSG, yeah.
Yeah. Also, like, I've been actually really enjoying his content a lot recently.
I was so mad at TLSG today. I was the only one who made the, I can't say the W sound for Los, so WW Los. Cam says it. It's just my brain refuses to make the words happen in that way. The sounds happen with that
Wylos?
Way. It's Wawalos, I believe.
Wawalos?
Yeah, okay. But whatever. The deck that, like, we had our, like, one of our most successful videos with it, and none of the other content creators were, like, making videos about it yet. And I was like, I got him. I got a day early. This is what I've been trying to do for, like, is I really work hard at that. Like, genuinely, like I'm looking for these decks. I'm like, all right, what's really good? What's got the win rate and, like, the proper, like, support from the right creators that, like really good people? And I, like, nailed it, and I had this video, and I made it, like, and it was killing it today. And the only content creator of everybody who made a video of it is TLSG. And I was like, you son of a...
I mean, he's good about
oh,
that.
Oh, he's really good.
He is very good about that.
He made a video about the ghost deck that Safety made for me. And I was like, you son of a bitch. I was going to make a... Like, you stole my ghost deck. It was made for me. Like, I'm not making a video about it after TLSG does that. What the fuck is the point of that?
But these are sort of the people that I'll be paying attention to in a couple weeks. But high evo is whenever I realize at work that the card is live, I will go in, press the button, and start getting some high evolutionary decks. I'm like very excited for that card, particularly for the inflict cards in it. So
it's gonna be very cool.
It's gonna be very cool. All right, Glazer, tell us who is your content creator of the week.
He's not a huge content creator. Like, he doesn't have a lot of place to follow him, but it's Tori Turrican. Tori is one of the best players in Marvel Snap. He basically finishes second in every Marvel Snap tournament. He's got that, and like three people are going to get this, but he's got that like Seth Lowe thing where he just finishes second all the time. Yeah, that was for Roy. He made a whole face and fell apart, which is exactly what I was going for. Oh shit, no, there's one thing we forgot to talk about.
What did we forget to?
7 cubes and 50 to 30. I am actually really want to hear your take about that. And then I'll continue telling you about Tori, because I don't know how I feel about it at all. So I'm just trying to gather information to form an opinion.
I think it feels better overall, for me at least. It makes it, when you win an 8-cuber, makes it feel like more like, yeah, I want an 8-cuber, because you like are guaranteed to go up. Mm-hmm. It also hurts more when you lose an 8-cuber because you're guaranteed to go down. And I think what it does is it sort of, I think we won't really know how it feels until we do the next reset. Because as I understand it with the math, it's actually the same number of cubes except at the beginning. Mm-hmm. So it's the same number of like overall cubes. So it's just going to make that initial like, the worst part of every climb since they changed the system is going from, say, for example, let's say you barely played it a month and you went all the way down to 20, to go from 20 to 30. Like, that is the worst and most miserable part of it, or from 70 to 80 or whatever. And then, you know, it kicks in and it starts going pretty fast. I mean, I haven't experienced that yet. So I think I'll have a better sense of it at the end of the month, or not the end of the month, beginning of the next month. So that's my take.
Yeah,
that's why I skipped it. I'm very
sorry. I just don't have an opinion, and I'm trying to get one. I'm trying to like, I can't. It feels like I'm grabbing sand. Okay, sorry. So Tori is Turrican Snaps on Twitter. He posts amazingly good takes. He is incredibly smart. He's also currently writing for SnapFan. He did a giant tournament meta review, and because he is such a stellar tournament player, you really, really need to read it. Check Turrican out. Follow him on Twitter. Make sure you're reading his articles. You will be a better player for it.
All right. So our variant of the week is Wave. Glazer, which one do you like the most?
It didn't open for me. Give me one second. Sorry. I opened it and this
page. I will let our loyal listeners in on it. Besides the Dan Hip, who's always my default, I'm going to go with the... I can never pronounce this. Is it Lennon? Lenol? Francis Yu? I've never been with Francis Yu. Yeah. Lionel Francis Yu's Wave here. I really like... I also think she has a pretty good pixel variant, all things considered. Yeah. But definitely Diana Hip followed by Francis Yu down there. Those are my picks.
So Dan Hip is the one I use. It is one of my favorite variants in the game. But apparently I don't like the Francis Yu, and I usually prefer the comic ones. But the Miko Suyan was apparently the beta version of Core Wave.
Interesting.
And everyone's been waiting for it to come out, and it's finally coming out in one of those new player bundles that like no one's being offered.
Well, new players are being offered.
Sure.
We're not new players.
Sure, anymore. But like then there's no access for anyone else for these because it's a bundle variant. And that's extraordinarily shitty. So, but I really, really love that variant and would use it perhaps even over Hip, and that's rare. But I can't because they released it in a weird way. I hope that they reconsider this decision. The Peach Momoko Thor was also gorgeous and is also released the same way.
The Peach Momoko Thor is very cool. I don't shed too many tears. It's a variant, I think, rewarding newer players with this opportunity that those of us who have been around forever don't have. It's not like the end of the world. Like, the world is, we're fine. we can go out and, quote, canvas, go out there and touch grass. We'll be fine. Just because we didn't get one type of fancy pixels, we'll be okay.
Fair enough.
We'll be okay. All right. So that brings us to the end of this episode. First and foremost, I want to thank Cam Best for joining us again. We really appreciated having him on. Make sure you check him out on Twitter. Make sure you check him on Twitch. Make sure you check out his YouTubes, which is, of course, the second best YouTube channel out there besides our own, of course.
More like KM's second best.
No, there we go.
He was such a great guest. He was such a freaking
guest. He was such a great guest. All right. So to maximize the time with Cam, I did not go through our normal ad read of all of our socials. So I'm going to literally go through all of them again here with all of my normal jokes. So you can find us at SnapJudgeCast on Twitter. So if you are out there engaging with Elon Musk, you can definitely do that and engage with us as well. We are Snap Judgments Podcast on Facebook. So if you are sending Mother's Day messages to your grandmother, you can definitely also engage with us there. We are, for some reason, on TikTok at Snap Judge Cast. We are, of course, the official podcasting partner of Snap Fan, and we are on their Discord. We have our own channels there. Snap Fan is, of course, the best Marvel Snap aggregating website, and we are really honored to be their partners, and we really love their community. They have the best large Discord community out there in Marvel Snap, and we have a small little sub-community there as our channels, which you should definitely check out. There are Snap Judgments up in there. You can email Chris, Will, and I at our email, which we will hopefully see between all of the TikTok spam that Glazer inflicted upon us. And our email is snapjudgmentspodcast@gmail.com. We are on everyone's favorite extinct animal social media, Mastodon, which is our Mastodon is snapjudgments with an E at tabletop.vip. And most importantly, we have a YouTube channel at Snap Judgments Pod. Glazer, tell our listeners, our loyal listeners who made it to this end here, a little bit more about that giveaway that you mentioned in our earlier discussion.
All right, sub to our YouTube. There's going to be a video going up on Monday. All you have to do is comment your YouTube username, and there'll be a question in the video. You comment those two things, and you will be entered to win one of five season passes. In addition to those five season passes, one of those five will be a grand prize winner who will win not only those five season passes, but also every single Token Tuesday for the month of June. So make sure you are subbed to the YouTube and you can get access to this giveaway.
Awesome. All right, that brings us to the end of our 26th episode. It's crazy to think that we've been doing this basically for 26 weeks straight. I don't think technically we kind of missed a week last week, but we did record an episode. So I think that was the first time we've missed a week since we started this. And so 26 straight weeks we've been doing this. So Aaron, my friend, thank you so much for joining me over these last 26 weeks.
Half a year.
I know, half a year. All right, my friends, have a great night, loyal listeners, and make sure you stay safe and keep on snapping.
Peace.